Attention. At this moment, you are now listening to
a Radio 1 show.
Fist of Fun.
Coming to you from the Paris studios in London.
And what a popular studio that is from the sound of it. I'm Stuart Lee, and you may call me Richard Herring. Welcome, 1FM listeners, joining us here at the Paris studio, London, to the last of the series of Fist of Fun.
Fist of Fun.
That's right. Now, Fist of Fun quite literally looks at the world this week from the perspective of two men who live in Tooting and haven't had time to read any newspapers or anything. We've had all of two reviews in the national newspapers. The Enemy called the show brilliant, whereas the Melody Maker took a slightly different view, saying it was shite.
So critical opinion sharply divided there. Yeah. Right on the cusp of the brilliant shite interface on that one.
Anyway, because it's the end of the series, we've been allowed to bring in games. I've brought in Mousetrap with the traditional one vital piece of mechanism missing. My French exchange partner's playing cards with pictures of naked women on them. And of course my Game Boy, which I'm playing Mystic Quest.
No, you were an idiot to bring that in, Rich, because the expensive toy always gets smashed, doesn't it?
So what have you brought in then,
Claire? Well, what I've brought in is a set of small dolls that I've made of all the people in the entertainment industry who have lied to me, lied about me, and cheated on me in the last 4 years. And some sharp skewers.
Fist fact. When Fist of Fun first started broadcasting way back in October 1993, a first-class stamp cost 24p. It is now 25p. What a different place the world is thanks to Fist of Fun.
Fun.
You know, there have been a lot of important things that have happened in the last 6 weeks, but for me, the most terrible tragedy has been that Rainbow is returning, but Jeffrey from Rainbow is not going to be in the series, which I think Stuart, perhaps we can do something about it, can't we? Ladies and gentlemen, will you please welcome here tonight, Jeffrey from Rainbow!
Thank you.
Hello, Jeffrey from Rainbow.
Hello, Rich.
Before we go on, I've always wondered, who is it who dreamt up the amazing sort of surreal concept of Rainbow?
What do you mean, Rich? It wasn't dreamt up by anybody. No, it was, in fact, TV's first fly-on-the-wall documentary series. I first met Zippy George Lambungle back in 1971 at art school.
Right.
And we decided to rent a place together, you know, just to save on the living expenses.
Didn't you think at the time, Jeffrey from Rainbow, that, you know, Zippy, George and Bungle were a bit odd, weren't they?
Stu, baby, this was 1971, remember? Things were really wild back then. We found a nice, cheap place in Lubbock Grove, and one day a TV producer friend of mine came round, and he said, what an amazing combination of personalities. We ought to put this on the telly, you know. Well, we thought he was barmy. I mean, who'd be interested in an ordinary man, a bear, a pink hippo, and a sort of zip mouth thing? But you know, guys, it did work. And for 20 years, the camera crew would come round about midday, set the cameras rolling, and, well, whatever we were doing that day, that would be the day's show.
So, didn't you have any human friends, Jeffrey?
Of course I did, yeah. Well, not strange or anything. Well, no, don't forget, there was Rod, Jane and Freddie. They were living in the flat downstairs. They're only living together to save on the living expenses,
yeah,
you know.
You know, I used to really like Jane, actually. Her, Janet Ellis and the blonde one from ABBA must take joint responsibility for the awakening of my sexuality, actually.
Didn't you ever stop to think, Jeffrey, though, I'm 51 years old, it's time I stopped living with felt animals. Cartoon house, you know, and got a job, found a place of my own, you
know? Stu, don't be rude. Jeffrey from Rainbow is our guest.
It's all right, Rich. No, I don't mind. I mean, see, the thing is, Stu, I got on so well with the guys. We were just rebels. The original Generation X.
So, Jeffrey from Rainbow, if you got on so well, why the split from the other Rainbow guys?
Basically, it's the new TV bosses, you see. They're to blame. I went down the shops the other day just to buy some crayons. Then when I got back, I found all my stuff in bin bags on the front lawn. All my wonderful, colourful shirts, my storybook. everything. Back in the 70s, when we'd signed the contracts, we'd all been a bit naive, you see, especially George. We just signed all our rights away. Anyway, the TV bosses have already let my room out to a politically correct female puppet.
A puppet? How pathetic. I mean, what next? Are they going to say Zippy is replaced by a puppet, are they? Or George? Who's going to tell Zippy off now, eh, if he steps out of line? He's going to tell a puppet to piss off, isn't he? Well, Fist of Fun listeners, you've heard the facts. TV boss Dawn Airy, who axed Jeffrey from Rainbow, said this week, "We have listened to public opinion, but have they? Have they, f***?" Who here thinks that Jeffrey from Rainbow should still be in Rainbow? Yeah! That, Dawn Airy, is the real public opinion.
Fist of Fun says TV boss Dawn Airy is a fool if she thinks Rainbow will be any good without Jeffrey from Rainbow. It is she who should be replaced by a puppet. If you agree, please write to Tetra Films of London, 175 Tottenham Court Road, London. Remember to mark your envelopes. Dawn Airy should be replaced by a puppet. And see how she likes it.
We're handing around a petition here in the studio, which we want you all to sign by the end of the programme. We suggest you do the same at your school, college or workplace. Together, we can win!
Thanks, guys, for having me along. Listen, before I go, though, if there are any animals made of felt out there looking for a flatmate, then please let me know. Thanks.
Fun.
Thought for the week. The Duchess of York is to go on an expedition to Everest. If the royal family are to go exploring, couldn't they go somewhere where no one has ever been, like the deep hole at the end of my road, filled with dead rats and excrement? I've always wondered what's at the bottom of that.
Fist.
Now it's time for another of our natural breaks. Try and imagine, if you can, for one horrible second, that Ian Cranky of the Crankies has abused the trust placed on him by his parents and had sexual relations with his little brother, wee Jimmy Cranky. Well, the resulting child, we think, would not look too dissimilar to our regular lifestyle contributor. Please welcome Peter Bainham.
Hello, I'm Peter, and today I've got advice for one and all, from the single man of 30 to the single man of 30 whose brother's disappeared, owing me a pound. We all know how exciting it is to order a pizza over the phone, because you get to speak to somebody else. But of course it's too expensive, and anyway I haven't got a phone. I've tried writing to them, but it's not the same really. So here's my recipe for budget delivery pizza for when you haven't got a phone. What you need is a slice of white bread. There you go. Some tomato sauce. There. A packet of cheese Wotsits. Some tunes. And a doll. Take the bread and pour some tomato sauce on it, like that. And then sort of smear it on with your hand. There you go. Then take the Wotsits and sort of pour them on the bread like that. That's like the cheese topping, isn't it? It's nice. It's a topping. And then finally take a couple of tunes on the top. There you go. Olive. Finally, take the doll, give her the pizza. And then you stand the doll outside the front door. For about 30 minutes and then open the door and say, "Hello there," and take the pizza off her and give her a pound and then eat the pizza like that. But there's one thing you've got to remember with this, which is very important. Don't leave it more than 30 minutes before going and collecting the pizza from the doll, because then you'll have to make some garlic bread for her to give you as well as compensation for it being late. Now, it's a special bit now. I've invited my special celebrity guest along, and he's the man who supplies all the specialist ingredients for my recipes. So please welcome my news agent from Balham, Raj Patel. How are you then?
I'm all right.
Do you want to tell everyone about the shop?
It's Maston News. We're in Bedford Hill. Balham.
82, isn't it?
92.
92. Sorry.
That's all right.
We've got a very good relationship, haven't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, because Raj always saves the best Pop-Tarts for me. How are the extras selling then?
Extras?
What you know, these extra strong mints, but I call them extras.
Extras. Oh, that extras.
Yeah, yeah.
They're all right, I suppose.
Yeah, good. Because I was sort of wondering, like, you know when you go to the big market, the big extra strong mint market, and you buy them? I don't know where it is, but you go and... How can you tell a really good packet of extra strong mints?
I don't know. Just buy them.
That's good then, isn't it? Do you like travel the world, sort of looking for exotic ingredients like red jam and that?
No, not really.
I wanted to admit something to you, actually. This is a bit embarrassing. You know when you're shat in the night?
Yeah.
I go along there sometimes, sort of window shopping.
Do you?
Yeah. Yeah. I sort of like look in the windows and look at the sweets and everything.
You know we got shutters?
Yeah, I look through the little holes.
Do you?
Yeah. Can you tell me something, Nancy? Do you ever get, like, real weirdos coming in your shop?
No. Sometimes. All right.
Thank you. Raj Patel, thank you very much.
Tory Minister Michael Howard this week blamed Britain's latest crime wave on the single mother. And that single mother was Jill Peterson of Bradford in Yorkshire, who took advantage of her son Jake's nap between 2 and 2:30pm to commit over 90% of this country's muggings, murders and industrial espionage.
Fun.
It's really good fun.
Fun.
But this week we've all been made aware of the case of Lorena Bobbitt, who cut off her cheating husband's penis. Yes, which either makes us laugh or wince. Depending, strangely enough, on whether we have a penis or not.
To find out more about it, we've got the woman in question on the phone, live from Manassas, Virginia. A big hand for Lorena Bobbitt.
Evil dick. Evil dick.
Hi, hello to you. Hi, Rich. Thanks for having me on the show.
Lorena, what made you commit this terrible act?
Well, was constantly unfaithful to me and used to get drunk and taunt me. So eventually I just got fed up with it, you know. And one night while he was asleep, I took a knife and and then I drove up into the night and threw it in a field, and I think that taught the bastard.
So, Lorena, did the police find the penis in time to sew it back on?
Oh, no, Stu. I threw the rest of him in the field. I kept the penis. Useful bit of him anyway, and I find it a lot less messy around the house. It doesn't sit around watching baseball all day, and it's nice and quiet, and I don't need to worry about washing and ironing clothes. Right. Simple sock is enough with maybe a bow tie for special formal occasions. It never embarrasses me in public like John used to either.
Yeah, but you know, there must be some things that a man can do that a penis can't, you know, like DIY, for example.
No, it's still very useful for, say, putting up shelves, knocking in the new nails, and of course clawing out the old ones if you get my meaning.
Thanks, Lorena. I think we better leave it there, actually.
My pleasure.
On line two, we have Lorena's unfortunate husband, John. Hi, John.
Hello.
John, how do you feel about what's happened?
First, I was traumatized, obviously. I woke up, I was in a dark field, I was naked. You know, I was covered in blood. I had no dick. After a few minutes, I thought, no, come on, let's be rational, John. You know, maybe things aren't so bad. Maybe this releases me from my previous social stereotyping and the restrictions of machoism. There's got to be a positive side to this experience. Still, I haven't figured out what it is.
Mr. Bobbitt, it seems that John's been cut off. Enough.
I feel I can sympathise with him, though, because what happened to John is very similar to my experience with the laser down at the Tooting St George's Hospital Genitourinary Infections Clinic.
I know how he feels as well. I woke up this morning, looked down and thought, oh no, my penis has gone, someone's cut it off. Then I realised it was still there, it's just my stomach had got in the way.
What Lorena Bobbitt's done is at odds with the new feminism of people like Naomi Wolf, that we've... we've been hearing about. What new feminism from the States says, in a nutshell, is that women have only themselves to blame for their oppression, can't expect to get into bed with a bloke and not have sex with him, and if they want to wear short skirts and revealing clothes, then that's fine.
Which, ironically, is basically what my dad and his mates in the pub have been saying for about the last 30 years.
Fist of Fun.
Being on Radio 1 has actually changed my life. 5 weeks ago, if you told me I'd be hobnobbing with the likes of Dale Winton of Supermarket Sweep or Jeffrey from Rainbow, I'd have said you were mad. But during the last 5 weeks, I've been trying to see what I could get out of this experience, you know. I've actually written to Sega and Nintendo to see what they would do if I would sort of give them a positive plug over their rival on the air. Here's what happened when I spoke to Sega's publicity agent at Lynn Frank's PR.
Hello, Lynn Frank.
Hello, could I speak to someone handling the Sega account, please?
Who's calling?
It's Richard Herring from Fist of Fun.
Hello.
Hello, who's this I'm speaking to?
Wendy,
hello. This is Richard Herring from Lee and Herring's Fist of Fun from Radio 1.
Hi.
I sent Sega a letter a couple of weeks ago. I don't know if it's got to you.
No, I haven't.
Basically, we're doing a sort of wacky Radio 1 show for late nights. And I was thinking, you know, there's a lot of young people out there listening to it. And if I sort of mentioned Sega a lot during the show, then that might be quite good for Sega.
Brilliant.
But, like, in return, what I would like, you know. We'd have to do this sort of under the table sort of thing, but in return, if you sort of gave me all loads of stuff, you know, like the Mega Drive and games and stuff, it'd be really good.
Possibly, but Radio 1 won't say Sega anyway.
They will, because it's my show and I would just say what I want. I'm Richard Herring, so it's a possibility, you think.
Do you want to send us a tape of your show?
Yeah, we can do that, yeah.
That'd be great. So, okay, and why don't you fax me through the letter?
Okay.
Great.
How much do you think I could sort of look to be getting from you for this thing?
It's kind of a lengthy discussion. It really depends what you can do for us, and then we sort of strike an agreement that, you know, we're both happy with.
Right, I see. So
I'm quite happy to give a product in return for mentions.
You're happy to keep it, like, out of not tell the BBC that this is what's going on, obviously, because I'd get into a lot of trouble. So you'd have to keep it secret if you were prepared to do that.
We would have to, you know, try it, I think, and see how it went.
Yeah. Also, just because it's Lynn Franks, isn't it? Yeah,
that's right.
That's the woman that Absolutely Fabulous is based on, isn't it?
Right.
I was wondering, the character that Julia Sawala plays on Absolutely Fabulous, is that based on anyone at Lynn Franks as well?
No, it's not based on a Lynn Franks employee. It was based on her daughter.
No one who looks a bit like her, maybe.
No, not that I know.
Right, because I just really like her, so I was just I'm trying to get in contact with Julia Sawala, but she's not like interested in me. So I was thinking maybe if there was someone who's a bit like her.
We don't have anything to do with that, I'm afraid.
Oh, OK. All right, well, I'll get back to you. I'll look forward to talking to you again.
Great.
OK, lovely.
Thanks
a lot.
See
you. Bye-bye.
So I sent Wendy a copy of the show, but she actually never got back to me or returned my calls, unfortunately. Still, that was a top-class piece of investigative reporting into the big company corruption, I think you'll find.
Well, yeah. But you'd have kept the stuff, wouldn't you, if they'd offered it you? And the Julia Sawala as well, probably.
I didn't get anything, and I have to say, because of that, all Sega products are rubbish. And I always find the ZX81s very good for games. Which is all I've got. Time's still young. If there is anyone out there, you know, or any game system willing to think again, and I could get something maybe in the post, if you know what I mean, then we'll see what we can do for the next series if we have one. And that also applies to any chocolate manufacturers or Scare Electric or cars or anything.
Fun.
Thought for the week. The beast of Bodmin Moor still remains at large, slaughtering innocent sheep and goats. Speculation as to what this fearsome beast can be include a puma, a wild dog, and Cornish farmer Philip Fry taking his revenge on former lovers.
Mind you, the people of Somerset are so dim, aren't they, that they, the beast of Bodmin probably isn't a monster at all. It could be just an old, ordinary household cat, or a gaily coloured kite that's become entangled in a tree.
Yeah, there you go again. So you're having a go at Somerset again. I'm actually surprised no one has written in over the series to complain.
Well, I'm not, really. Considering that they've only got one pen down there between them. And that's a quill pen, which they use for tickling the demons out of the mad folk.
Bill of Somerset, if we get together, we can defeat this ridiculous stereotype. You know, like, it's a bit like the story of the 101 Dalmatians, isn't it, who work together to defeat Cruella de Vil.
Is it really?
Yeah, it is.
To be honest, Rich, I don't see what relevance... And you're with me on this secretly, aren't you? I don't see what relevance a story about dogs working together to save some other dogs can possibly have to do with you and the people of Somerset, can it? And this is the fourth time I've told you about this. I don't pay any heed to stories which anthropomorphise animals, right?
Right.
Animals do not possess human qualities or abilities. Haven't you been listening to what I've said?
No, I haven't, actually. I find it makes things easier in the long run.
All right. Well, for one last time,
Let me retell an old animal story in a way which bears some relevance to 20th century human life.
Stuart Lee's True Fables.
This week, 101 men. Once upon a time, when the world was young, there lived a wicked, evil woman called Cruella de Vil.
Cruella de Vil, Cruella de Vil. If she doesn't scare you, no evil thing will. To see her is to take a sudden chill. Cruella, Cruella de Vil.
And 101 men.
Hello!
Cruella de Vil.
Now, Cruella had an evil plan. She wanted to make a suit out of men's skins, in which she could then prance around in front of a mirror in a dark room full of candles housed in the skulls of her victims. And Cruella calculated that to make this bizarre suit, she would need the skins of exactly 101 men. All too soon, the exciting day came.
Excuse me, man one. I am trying to load this sofa into this van in the dark for some reason. But as you can see, I have a broken arm in a splint. Ooh, ah, ow. Will you help?
Well,
Oh, come on, it isn't a trick nor anything. Go on.
All right, then.
In you go.
Cruella de Vil. Cruella de Vil.
Over a period of some months, Cruella continued her scheme, preying on weak men.
There you go then, man 67, into that pit.
I've been stripped and flung into a pit with a large number of other naked men.
Hello.
Oh, yeah, man 67, pleased to meet you. I'm man 51, right? I've got a bit of bad news for you, though. Well, we're all being held here against our will, right? And when we're thin enough, Cruella de Vil is going to kill us and hang us up by our feet and then flay us.
Oh, dear. What is to do?
And so the disappearances continued, until one day, while Cruella was flaying a man's corpse.
And I can use this bit to put up my shelves. Good. Oh. Someone at the door.
There, on Cruella's doorstep, were two inquisitive-looking Dalmatian dogs, their hackles raised and growling fiercely at the strange woman. Had they come as some kind of heroic canine guardian angels to save the imprisoned 101 men when all human efforts had failed hopelessly? Well, no, they hadn't, obviously. But the whole point of the True Fables is to demonstrate that in real life, animals have no intellectual capacity beyond pure basic instinct. Far from coming to save the men, the dogs were probably only attracted to the house by the smell of the rotting flesh. Anyway, so Cruella gave them a bone each, and thus their basic canine needs fulfilled, they quickly ran off to go and roll around in manure and sniff each other's arses. Thus, Cruella was able to finish her capture, imprisonment and murder of the 101 men she needed, and then make the man-skin suit she'd wanted for so long. And very nice it was, too. And the moral of that story is that although some serial murderers are caught, many, like the Zodiac Killer, evade all police efforts to track them down.
Not the usual light tone of our True Fables there, Stuart.
No, well, the real world is more unpleasant than even Walt Disney could imagine, Ridge.
Thought for the week. Serial killer David Berkowitz, who shot 13 people in New York in 1976, this week apologised for his crimes in a TV interview. Fist of Fun says, good on you, David. Sorry is the hardest word to say. If only there were more people like you, the world would be a better place with a smaller population.
Yeah, the Evening Standard report on Berkowitz there finished by saying, having previously claimed his neighbour's dog told him to kill women, Berkowitz is now a born-again Christian.
So no improvement there, then,
not really.
It's weird that Berkowitz was told to kill people by a dog, though, isn't it? I mean, most serial murderers are told to commit their crimes by God.
Yeah, Berkowitz was dyslexic, though, Rich.
Fist of Fun.
The series is over, hey, but... You know, I've been thinking, Stu, you and I, right, we're living together now at the moment, I'm sharing your house at the moment, we spend all the time working together, you know. It's like a marriage, you know, and like a marriage, there's a lot of tension between us, isn't there, building
yes,
up, you
yes,
know.
Yes.
But in a marriage, if you get annoyed with each other or argue, you can always make it up with good, loving sex, can't you?
Yeah, but we can't do that, can we?
Well, we could.
No.
Yeah, I suppose you're right. We ought to be careful talking about homosexuality and stuff. I mean, the Clause 28 law forbids the promotion of the homosexual option over and above the heterosexual one.
Rich, this is Fist of Fun. It's the end of the series and we have no respect for the laws of society. Listen to this.
People of Britain, become gay now. It's really good. It's better than being heterosexual, easily.
Stu, won't we get into trouble for doing that?
No, because the legality of that statement depends on the intent behind it, right?
Right.
And our intent was to be needlessly controversial.
Right.
We don't really believe that homosexual sex is better than heterosexual sex.
No, what we believe is that homosexual sex and heterosexual sex are both equally dirty and wrong. And should be punishable by a £10 fine.
That's right.
Let's get the cast into bed with us. John Thompson.
Rebecca Front, jump into bed with us, please. Thank
Pete, get into bed. Yeah. I think that your bits have probably been the most popular items in the whole series.
Oh, thanks.
That's why, Pete, we're going to replace you with this little sock. I've made it into a puppet, right? Drawn a little face on it. Can you see? And it goes, hello, here's some recipes.
Sorry about that, Pete. So,
That's better, really.
It is better. And let's not forget, of course, Raj Patel. Do you want to come up and join us in the bed? What's the address of your news agent again?
92 Bedford Hill, Balham.
See, Sager, if you just bloody listen.
Yeah.
I'm laughing.
92 Bedford Hill for all your news needs.
And let's not forget, of course, Jeffrey from Rainbow. I'm actually looking for a new flat at the moment. Would you like to come and share with me?
What, share ours with a fat bloke from Somerset?
I think I'm mad. If you could do the honours now, Jeffrey from Rainbow.
Well, boys and girls, it's time for us all to go now, but we'll see you again soon. Take care. Bye.
Okay, bye.